The David Feldman radio program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps.
Frank Conniff.
When I worked with him, though, he was a
we're good, on the air.
He was
we're
a nice guy when I worked with him.
Frank Conniff is here, and Kristen Buckels. Hello, Kristen.
Hello.
Thanks for coming back.
Anytime.
Frank Conniff, you know him from Insight.
Sirius XM Insight.
Yes, with John Fugelsang.
Yes.
We just had a very successful episode with John Fugelsang talking religion.
And, oh, really?
Yeah, if you should catch it. Just go to davidfeldmanshow.com.
Okay. Oh, did John come down and do your
show? He came
down
and educated me on what I need to know about God and religion. Mm-hmm. And Kristen, do you know Frank Conniff?
We've just met today.
We just met. We have cats.
We both have cats, so we've already bonded in a big way.
Yes.
She has three cats, so that makes her, that gives her star status to me.
I made it.
Yeah.
Static.
Cats are very interesting. I'm tempted to get a cat.
You should.
You should.
I want to live with a murderer. Cats are
then
serial
those
killers.
Those are, yeah.
Right?
You should get a cat.
I have mice.
Oh, you'd be a great cat guy.
Outdoor cats are killers, right? They go out and kill birds. I've never had that experience. I know people who've had cats who live in the country, and the cats kill birds. And the common thing that I guess they always do is they bring them back to the house and, like, kind of present them to the...
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah.
My cats kill water bugs. And
good for them.
Yeah. And then they have... If you go to Michael's, you can get these little pom-poms with sparkly things on them for $2. And my cats worship these things.
Now, are you making the cats work for their food? That's the new theory. We had a,
what?
We did a show. If you go to my website.
Oh, your cat show that you got in trouble for.
Well, that's a... Tell them what happened.
Well, I think you did it. You did an entire show on cats right after the election. Because,
oh, I thought we were doing a bit.
Oh, I'm too tired for this.
Oh, okay. No, yeah, we did an entire show about cats. And
yeah.
The woman I interviewed says that you need to make the cats work for their food. That you just don't, like, you would not put.
I've never heard of that.
Yeah, you don't put a bowl of mice in front of a cat. The cat is a hunter.
Mm-hmm.
So you should take the food.
I've heard similar things to that, but it's too late with my cats for that. Way too late.
My favorite Barney story. Is you were
that's Barney, one of my cats.
You were this is just you were lying in bed, and Barney walked up to you and just scratched you, and you went "fuck you, Barney."
That's happened a few times.
He just walks up to you. He's in a bad mood.
If my foot is hanging over the side of the bed or my hand is hanging over the side of the bed while I'm sleeping, he'll jump up and bite it. You know?
What an asshole.
And he can't play nice. In other words, he's trying to he thinks it's playing, but it hurts when he plays. He really bites you.
Right.
Whereas my other cat, Millie, can like kind of grab at you and it doesn't hurt. But if you pick her up, she will scratch the shit out of you. She will fucking kill you if you try to pick her.
She doesn't
why
like it.
Every time I have to take her to the vet, it's one time I had to hire someone to help me get...
Stop.
Her into the cat carrier. And another time, a friend of mine who I think you know, Rachel Riskind in L.A., she works at with animals. She came over and helped me get
Millie. My sister has the same story. My sister rescued two black kittens. They were just covered in parasites and dying.
Mm-hmm.
And they were as big as her fist.
Mm-hmm.
And she had an eyedropper and she gave them milk and she nursed them back to life. Literally saved their lives.
Yep.
And they hide in the basement. They're feral, and there's nothing you can do.
Yeah. Well, Millie was a rescue from – she was found under a car, you know. So she has those issues, even though she's very domesticated now, and she knows how to chill out. And she likes it when I pet her, but under pre-agreed to conditions, you know. But she has like quirks and do not pick her up. She will not let you, she will never let me pick her up.
Will she sleep with you?
She sleeps on my bed. Yeah. Both Barney and Millie sleep on my bed when I'm sleeping.
And do they purr?
Sometimes. Yeah.
And what are the names of your cats?
Wally, Mac, and Violet.
Nice.
Wally, Mac, and Violet.
Mm-hmm.
And how old are they?
Wally's 4. I rescued him from the ASPCA.
Was that his name?
Yes. I just feel like it's kind of messed up to change their names.
Yeah, it confuses them.
Right. And I thought about it, but then I kept his name. And then Mac and Violet are both bodega kitties.
What does that mean?
There was a bodega down the street. My boyfriend and I lived in Crown Heights, and they had a cat there that just sort of kept getting pregnant, and eventually we got 2 kittens from her litters. So they're both bodega cats, and they're fat and happy.
And having a mother who's a whore.
How's that affected them?
Yeah.
I feel, this is actually kind of messed up. But we have
a lot of female cats are, they're shamed from exhibiting their sexuality.
Mm-hmm.
So she was, this is like a very modern.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, we have.
Does she come around and visit, or is it just she couldn't care less?
I mean, I don't live there. We don't live in that neighborhood anymore. I don't know what happened to her.
Do you think if that whore mother saw your cats, she would recognize them?
No.
She's that messed up.
Yes. She was pregnant 2 times before she was a year old. How awful is that?
I know Barney's mother, although I haven't.
You haven't spoken in a while.
Yeah, I haven't spoken in a while. But Teresa Strasser, who's some people listening to the show might know, is a good friend of mine. She was Finster, her cat's offspring.
Marty Ingalls is?
Yes.
Was Finster?
I'm Dickens, he's Finster.
That was John Astin.
John, yes. So I did know who her
But would the mother of a cat recognize its child?
I don't think if it hadn't seen it in a long time, I don't think it would. It's just like a human wouldn't know their child if it was taken away from them.
That's true.
When they were.
Yeah.
Do you love your cats?
I love my cats. They're crazy. They're so funny. Yeah. They're funny.
But cats, but you'd be crazy too.
Yeah.
If you were born to hunt and kill, mm-hmm. and you were trapped inside.
Yeah, that's why they act really crazy. I think the craziness of cats is a big part of their appeal. You know,
they're so funny.
They're funny, and they don't. And I love dogs, but they're mm-hmm. you know, dogs are suck ups. You know, they just desperately want approval from humans, and cats are like, their
the
attitude
opposite.
Is fuck you. You know, where's my food? Mm-hmm. Clean up my shit. Do your job. You're here to serve me, and I don't want to
totally.
Hear anything about it.
And what does it say about yous guys that you would be so passive and you would do that?
Because they're cats and we love cats.
They're so funny.
Yeah.
I have Wally will come every single morning. He comes and I don't feed them in the morning, so I feed them at night, and he will come and he'll just stand on you until you sort of get up and then pet him, and then he runs away. And he'll do this repeatedly for like an hour and a half, and it's like he's not interested in you really touching him. He just wants you to acknowledge that he's there.
My friend has a brother who has a cat named Nugget.
Mm-hmm. Nugget.
And Nugget will sit on the toilet and go.
Yeah, you can train them to do that.
Yeah.
It's the let me see if I have a video of it. It's the funniest
thing. Hold on. Are you picking up the phone to show me something?
You know what it is? The look on Nugget's face. She videotaped Nugget going.
Uh-huh.
And he had this look on his face, and you can hear the sounds going into the turlet.
Mm-hmm.
And the look on his face is, some privacy, please? Are you sick?
Yeah.
Like, is this some kind of fetish here? And it's one of the most amazing things I've ever seen.
Mm-hmm.
I would have a cat if I could. My brother-in-law tried to train one of the cats to use the turlet.
Mm-hmm.
And apparently what you do is you take the box and you put it next to the turlet.
Mm-hmm.
And each day you raise the box until it's at the same height as the turlet.
Mm-hmm.
And then the cat is supposed to say, oh, instead of sand, I should put this in water.
Mm-hmm.
And the stupidity of the cat is that they, because cats are stupid.
No.
Nugget uses the turlet.
Mm-hmm.
But he says toilet, though, so he's ahead of you.
That's fair. That's very fair.
Then Nugget will take his paws and mime covering the water with dirt. They do this thing where they try to bury
it. Yeah, my cats do a thing where they, for some reason, they'll scratch the wall next to the kitty litter box. I don't know why.
See, my cats scratch around their food dishes when they're done eating.
Do they have panic attacks when you're changing the box?
No.
That's the OCD of cats. I love watching
one thing, I use the scoopable cat litter, so I'm always just scoop the stuff out of it and then put new kitty litter in. You're never really changing the box.
And I had found that when I use the scoopable kitty litter that my...
You don't have cats, so I'm wondering why you use scoopable kitty litter.
Well, when I did have cats, we had scoopable kitty litter, but our pasta dishes tasted like cat shit. And then they never, on the box, it never said, do not use the scoop
For draining spaghetti?
Yeah.
That was the most laborious setup for such a little thing.
Hang on. I'm winded. Hang on. Woo. Oh, boy. The first joke I wrote for stand-up was in 1982.
Uh-huh.
And it said, I said, I've invented a wash and dry. Do you know what a wash and dry is?
A wash and dry? No.
Wash and dry. God, she's young. Remember wash and dry?
No.
Those were those little packets that had, a wet nap inside.
Okay. Wet naps. Yeah, I've heard of those.
Okay. I have wet naps every afternoon. Mr. Feldman, you want to wake up?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. It's okay. There's some tapioca pudding downstairs in the game room.
In the game room. That made it so much worse.
Don't be ashamed. Just anyway, the first joke I wrote was it's a wash and dry for cats who are too busy to clean themselves, and you open it up and inside is a pre-moistened paw.
Okay.
And I was very proud of myself because I remember saying to my friends, this joke is going to work because it's got the word paw in it and peace. This is 1982.
Uh-huh.
And moistened is a funny sounding.
It is a funny sounding.
Pre-moistened
paw.
I'm not a funny person.
That's pure bullshit. Mm-hmm. I remember when I first was in, we were working on that show, and I'm looking in the dock, and you can watch people write.
Mm-hmm.
And you and David Taylor were on a team in another room writing. And I remember just sitting there reading I could see which jokes you're writing and thinking, oh my God, I don't know how his brain works that fast. But you're a funny person.
Oh, because of Google Doc.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
You ever use Google Doc?
Sure.
It's fascinating because you can be all over the world working with somebody and see things being typed. And if you're an asshole, you can, if you know that somebody's reading your stuff.
You can type things.
You can type things.
You can say little messages.
And yes. And most of, I've noticed that there's a project I'm working on now that everything I write involves jerking off.
Mm-hmm.
This is everything. And then he jerks off. And then he touches his penis. And then he jerks off.
And this is stuff you write alone, right?
Yes. Well.
Hey! Most of what Feldman does is alone.
Kristen Buckels is very funny.
Thank you.
You are. And Frank Conniff has a new book out.
Yes.
About Mystery Science Theater.
Well, it's called 25 Mystery Science Theater Films That Changed My Life in No Way Whatsoever. And I use... It each chapter is about a different film that we did on the show, but I kind of use the films as kind of a jumping off point for a kind of stream of consciousness. It's kind of like I'm riffing the way we did when we looked at the movies. I'm just letting my mind go wherever it goes.
How many movies can you see in one day?
I'm not a person that these days that, I mean, I could see, you know, I could see, if I wanted to, I could watch movies all night at home. But I usually don't. At most, if I'm home at night, I'll watch one movie, you know. And then when I'm done watching a movie, I'm usually like, well, now I want to read or write or or waste time on the internet, you know. So I'm not a guy who these days, at least in my life, does like marathon movie watching, you know.
Last time you were on the show, Frank, we had a heated argument, and people loved it.
They did, okay.
So I'm trying to figure out how I can get into a fight with you.
It's not hard.
I'm looking. I'm looking for a fight with you.
Just okay. So I'm ready.
Let me ask you about fighting, Kristen.
Fighting?
Yes.
Okay.
I got into a shoving match on Monday.
A shoving match?
Yeah, and a little wrestling with somebody.
That's great.
And but it was affectionate.
It was affectionate. It was with someone, a good, it was with a relative. And she, no.
I was going to say.
It was an interesting situation because there were implicit ground rules. That we knew that there was not going to be a punch thrown. Mm-hmm. It was just like we were angry at each other, and this was somebody who was younger than I was and is a cousin of a cousin, and we kind of wrestled, and it was part funny but part anger, and it took me 3 days for my body to recover. And as a man, afterwards, I thought, boy, that felt great. I'm being serious. So that was like, that was, you know, like a hint of animal aggression, male on male fisting. And that night I went to a club.
Wait, you went to a club?
A dance club.
What are you doing at a dance club?
I'm kidding. A comedy club.
Great.
And just separate from what I had experienced, this guy who's about my age told me about a customer from Britain. Who ran out on a $100 bill, and the two of them got into a fight. They were, like, and this was fight. Serious. You know, my thing was a wrestling match with the cousin of a cousin, and it was half joking, half angry, but it felt like a fight. But he really got into it with this guy, and he said to me afterwards, he said the guy had his knuckle of his index finger grinding into right below his eye. He was about to lose his eye. He had his foot on the guy's neck, and it was like the standoff of, you know, I'll
crush. Was the Cirque du Soleil?
And he said, separate to what I had experienced, and you know what? It felt great.
Yeah.
He said, I almost lost my eye. I almost could have killed this guy. We both agreed to just let go of one another and hug and kiss. And he ran off. You know, I had to eat the $100.
Oh, God.
He said, but it was worth it. He said, it felt so good to be in a fight.
I don't get that.
That's how I feel when I shove somebody in the subway.
And the A train hits them?
Hopefully, yes. No, when you're coming off the train – and there's people coming on the train, and there's these people that will just go on. Like, do you not hear the, like, announcement that happens 18 times when you're on the subway to let people off before you go on?
That bugs me when people
I have zero problem shoving the shit out of somebody.
And does that feel good?
Oh, it feels great.
Why does it feel good?
I don't know. It just, it's like for like one moment, because there's no like telling, you know, there's no like stopping them. Excuse me, sir. I'm not sure if you're aware of the policy here that, you know, we're allowed off first and then you can go on. Because these people, they don't care. They just want the seat. They see the seat as it's pulling up and they have their eye on the prize and they just shove through people.
Right.
And it makes me mad.
Right.
And so it feels good to shove.
I'm a pacifist.
Not anymore.
Not anymore. You fought.
Yeah. Have you ever gotten into a fight?
Not since I was a kid. I used to fight with my brother.
Which is a safe way to fight.
Physical fights. I never.
Did
when
you
I
punch?
Was when I was younger, I did not. I don't know if I'd call them fights. It was more me getting beat up by people, you know, which happened to me growing up in New York. Getting beaten up by bullies and stuff. So that would be the last in my adult life that I can remember. I don't think I've gotten into a physical fight with anybody.
Then what about an argument?
Oh, I get into arguments, sure.
And does that feel good?
And I've argued with strangers on the street in New York. Shoving incidents is kind of where they bump into you and you're like, and hey, watch where the fuck you're going, man. You know, and then you yell at each other for a few minutes. Though I guess those things could escalate into physical fights, but they haven't in my case.
I think in New York.
Because I run like hell.
Well, New York City.
You're quite quick.
One of the things I discovered, having lived in New York City for 6 years and then moving to San Francisco, was in New York City, you can bump into somebody, give them the finger, tell them to go F themselves.
And continue about your day.
And then continue. And they go, have a nice day.
Right, right.
In San Francisco, you give somebody the finger, they're ready to kill you.
I've gotten into really vicious, in San Francisco, I've gotten into some vicious arguments over aesthetics.
But it does. So you and I were arguing about something.
Yeah, I don't even remember.
I don't remember, but I do remember it cleared my head.
Uh-huh.
And it's a bit of a narcotic, right? Mm. Arguing.
Yeah, it is. I mean, I think if you are very committed to your side, and believe in it strongly, it's fun. I on the John Fugelsang show, which I'm on every day on Sirius XM, I've being the big Hillary supporter that I was from the beginning of the campaign, I would get into a lot of arguments, and I would kind of start them because I would hear people say, you know, well, Hillary is, you know, one of her problems is she's so unpopular. And then I would jump in and say, no, that's actually not true. She's actually – so I would kind of jump in with these things that I believe were true from what I had read. And I, you know what, it's really fun to – I like arguing when you're kind of going against conventional wisdom. Like there's something very satisfying about that when people are saying something and they're mainly saying it because it's what everybody's saying. Mm-hmm. And then you come in and you have an alternate point of view. I kind of enjoy that.
Yeah. Yeah. The virtue of an argument when done right is it can reveal some truth. Most people think any conversation about what's going on in the world has to be an argument, that you cannot just exchange ideas. That is what I've observed. If somebody comes to my house for dinner after – they wake up and say, what happened to me? I say, please don't press. No. I like to know what's going on in the world, and you tell me what's going on, and then I'll tell you what's going on. I can't have friends who just automatically argue. They think you bring up
anything.
The only way to arrive at what the truth is if the two of us argue.
Right.
However, and I don't see anything good to that. However, with the Russian hacking, I do feel like I want to ask you some questions about it. And I do, and I think it's going to turn into an argument.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
All right.
We'll see. We'll look at the Russian transcripts later because they're listening in on this.
By the way, I had a funny idea. I pitched to a friend of mine who writes for a show where the host says, you know, enough with the Russian hacking. Can we just, it's not, and then the rest of the show is done in Russian. And he doesn't realize, he's just reading. Has anybody done that yet?
No, not yet.
So the idea would be that the teleprompter had been hacked by the Russians.
Everyone just goes on about, like,
the host is
happening.
Such a moron. He just reads what's on the teleprompter.
He's just reading Russian as if it's no big deal.
As far as TV shows goes, the much bigger problem is a lot of them are hacked by Lorne Michaels. So.
The bigger culprit.
Yes. Let's focus on the real enemies.
So, because I'm overwhelmed by what's going on in the news. And you do a daily talk show on SiriusXM. So you are up to date on everything that's going on.
I am very I'm very immersed in the world of scanning websites for headlines and then giving opinions. Yes, you're right.
Okay. they have said this is an act of war.
Who said that?
I think...
Facebook.
I think that it wasn't Obama, but somebody high up in the Obama administration said the Russians are hacking our democracy.
Well, let me just say I really hope it's not an act of war. I really don't want to go to war over this.
So, I want to understand this.
Uh-huh.
Explain some things to me, Mr. Conniff.
Okay.
Have we done any recounts in Pennsylvania, Wisconsin, or in Michigan?
My knowledge is that those recounts are over with now, or they didn't happen, or there was one. I didn't follow it that closely.
Well, Wisconsin, I think they finished the one in Wisconsin. They found out nothing changed, right?
No. So are you talking about Russian hacking into our voting?
Just let me ask you a line of questions to prove that you did, in fact, murder that child.
Okay.
Watch him. I'm going to trap him into this.
Okay.
We never really found out if they hacked into the voting, right?
I don't think that ever became a major issue.
But if the President of the United States and the CIA and the FBI are all on the same page, that the Russians have been...
They hacked the DNC is what they're on the same page about.
Right. But nobody's suggesting that perhaps we want to look at the votes, right?
That's not at the top of the list.
But if this is as bad as they say it is, you would think that they would want to look at some of these.
Well, I don't know, because I think it's probably a different – I think it's two different things from hacking, going into the DNC's emails, figuring out a way to hack into them, and then releasing them to the public is a separate thing from – however you – I don't even know how you would hack the vote, go into the voting machines and change the outcome or whatever. I don't think there's any evidence that that happened. But there is evidence, very strong evidence, that they hacked into the DNC.
Okay. Now, as a Hillary defender.
Yes.
Has this been brought up? I'm kind of curious.
What?
I haven't told you what this is yet.
Well, say what this is.
Okay. This is the
and
David
I'll come
Feldman
up with
show.
An answer that hopefully will make me look good.
Okay. Bernie Sanders said in the debate, enough with the emails.
Yes.
Enough with the emails. And they wouldn't let go of it.
Huh?
They wouldn't let go. The Republicans would not let go of Hillary using a private server.
Right. The Republicans or the mainstream media or many on the left as well.
Right. This hacking scandal.
Uh-huh.
Does this give credibility to the Republicans who complained about her using a private server? In other words, let me just finish. The Russians were able to hack into the Democratic National Committee's server and find out embarrassing things and give them to WikiLeaks.
Right.
Doesn't that suggest that the Republicans were right, that Hillary should not have had a private server over at state?
Don't say Republicans, because it's Republicans and the New York Times and the mainstream media. It's not just a Republic. Her emails is not just something the Republicans brought up. It's something everybody jumped on.
Okay. So if the Russians were able to get into the DNC server, wouldn't the Secretary of State be obligated to use a private the State Department server and not a private server to make sure that classified top secret emails were not hacked by the Russians? So doesn't this scandal kind of make Trump and Chaffetz and these people look somewhat right for questioning her use of a private server?
No.
Okay. Has that been discussed at all?
I don't know. If people I was hoping maybe now that the election happened that Hillary's private email server would be something that the people who talked about it incessantly during the election would be embarrassed about by now. But you still want to bring it up. So people still want to talk about it. I think there's nothing in our in our democracy or in the coverage of the election that is more indicative of how awful everything is in terms of our media, in terms of our coverage of the election, in terms of the election itself, the fact that people even gave a shit about Hillary's private email server. The network news did more stories. The nightly network news did more stories about Hillary's emails than any other story in the election combined. So that's a fact. Yes. Okay. So I think that, if people aren't embarrassed by the fact that the emails got so much coverage, they should be. I think it's going to be a historical thing that people are going to look back if on the wreckage of this country and look back at the coverage of this election and look back at how much the media made of these emails. It's a scandal on a major scale.
Explain to me what the Republicans were complaining about with the email.
I don't know what the fuck they were complaining about. Why are you still talking about her emails? Who gives a shit?
Because
it means nothing.
But if then is the Russian hacking of our democracy as the Democrats are complaining about?
Well, they're complaining about it's not the Russians hacking of our democracy. It's the Russians hacking of the DNC.
Right. And is it a big story? I know it's
getting the fact that a foreign power tried to help Donald Trump get elected president, especially considering the fact that he's so friendly to Putin and he's his Secretary of State is like a friend of Putin's. I think that does
Rex Spillerson.
Yeah, it makes it a big story. Absolutely,
Rex Spillerson because he's the head of Exxon.
Yes,
it's Tillerson, but. I call him Rex Spillerson.
That's clever. Yeah.
Thank you. Are you patronizing me?
Excuse me?
But going back, and then I'll move on. If we're upset that the Russians hack the DNC and cyber war is the new frontier, this is where we're going to be fighting our battles. Right?
And it's probably a good thing that Hillary used a private server.
You may be right.
Then maybe she had better protections for it than because government servers have been hacked as well. Mm-hmm. That's a thing that's happened. So, in other words, whether she used a private server or government server, who gives a shit? That's my that's what I would say about that.
I think you said who gives a shit.
Snail mail. When's the last time you wrote a letter, Kristen Buckels?
Wrote a letter. Oh, gosh. Maybe like last year sometime.
It's amazing, isn't it?
Yeah.
If it's a given that Yahoo, like we just learned that anybody who has an account with Yahoo
is obsolete.
All your passwords have been revealed.
Yeah, and you know what's really embarrassing in those things that's revealed is that they had accounts with Yahoo.
Yeah, that's the reveal.
But then again, now Verizon.
Uh huh.
Is trying to buy Yahoo. Mm-hmm. Let's say they want to buy Yahoo for, I don't know what the number is, but let's say they want to buy Yahoo for, what is Yahoo worth? $2?
Let's say
$5 billion. Mm-hmm. What's to stop Verizon from saying, let's hack Yahoo, embarrass them, and lower the purchase price?
That seems like a clever plot. Mm-hmm.
That's why I'm using snail mail.
Mm-hmm. From now on,
I just write all. None of this stuff. Go ahead.
I think the funnier part of any of this is that anyone thinks that any amount of privacy isn't actually a thing anymore.
Yeah, that's true.
I just don't. Even like when people are like, "Oh, like should I write down my social security number?" It's like if you think that there's a person on this planet that can't figure out what your social security number is with a few Google searches and a buddy who knows how to, like, you know, work with computers, you're nuts.
Mm-hmm.
I really firmly believe that. I think that everyone's watching everything we do and it's just kind of like, okay.
1 out of 25 Americans are victims of revenge porn.
Mm-hmm. For people who don't know revenge porn, it's when people film pornography of me and send it to people as retaliation for whatever it is they're mad about.
Okay.
1 out of 25 Americans say they've been victimized by revenge porn. and the rest are okay with it.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
Have you allowed anybody to take pictures of you?
No.
Have you allowed anybody to take pictures of you?
I never have. They're welcome to. No one has offered to. It's never come up. If someone wants to give me $10 for dick pics, let's talk about it.
Alex, have you ever?
Here. He's available.
Have you ever posed, or has a woman ever posed for you? And really, it's a generational thing, huh?
In female
undergarments. Wow,
Alan.
And do you still have them? But they're
around. Trust me.
But they're on your phone, right?
They're
around. You
deleted
them? This generation.
Yeah. Well, we came from the print porn generation. So the first time I actually had a woman, I was looking for the staple, you know.
I can only come when I'm with a woman. But first, let me start again.
Take it from the top.
I can't come unless I first put a staple gun into a woman's navel.
My favorite part about Feldman is watching how much he enjoys his own jokes.
Yes.
All right. Trump Tower.
Mm.
Built by illegal.
I'm selling my apartment there. I've had it. Yes.
Really? Built by illegal Polish people. Did you know that?
I did know that.
Yes.
But they were Italian. It's a Polish joke there somewhere, which I didn't get to. But I was trying.
There were Polish workers, undocumented, mm-hmm. who built Trump Tower.
Right.
With
the
The Gambino family helped Mr. Trump.
Sure.
Right?
He's mobbed up. There's no doubt about that. It's been written about them. The mainstream media doesn't give a shit.
Right.
One of the many egregious things about Donald Trump that the people, the powers that be, don't care.
Right. If it weren't for AIDS, Roy Cohn would be our attorney general right now.
Maybe, yeah. I mean, people forget Roy Cohn was Donald Trump's mentor.
Yeah.
He in the Trump Tower, he built a closet for him.
That was nice.
And Roy Cohn was the lawyer to the mob.
To the mob and Joe McCarthy's legislative assistant.
Yes. Can you build
a good movie about him with James Woods. Have you seen that movie, Citizen Khan?
It was Nicholas von Hoffman's book.
Very, very good.
Remember Nicholas von Hoffman?
Yeah, sure.
So can you build a casino in Atlantic City without being mobbed up? Can you build in New York City without being mobbed up?
I doubt it. The construction industry, and I'm going with a cliche here, is traditionally it's very mobbed up. People right. Get into the jukebox business to get less mobbed up.
That's how mobbed up.
Yeah. Trump Tower was built with cement, not steel. Did you know that?
I probably knew that, but those kind of facts don't really.
So there's no steel in Trump Tower. There's some stealing, but no steel. Right. Hang on. Let me wait for the audience to stop laughing.
Let's pause for a minute.
All right, guys. It wasn't that funny. I need a big laugh on that one. Mm-hmm. Alex, you sweetening this? Okay. You can save a lot of money with the cement.
Mm-hmm.
But in order for the cement to work properly, mm-hmm. you have to be mobbed up. Because the cement is going to... Mm-hmm. harden before you get it into the ground. So
just like Trump hardens whenever his daughter is around.
Oh, that was good, and it rhymed.
Uh-huh. All right, so Trump Tower could not have been built without the mafia.
Right.
He's mobbed up. Mm-hmm. And it was originally not Bergdorf Goodman. What was this store that Trump...
Oh, I don't... You know what? I have never been in Trump Tower. And I'm...
Me either.
My impression of it is that you go in and it's like a mall, right? There's stores and stuff. And that's...
Yeah. But it was originally a famous department store that had some mm-hmm. fantastic Art Deco mm-hmm. work that he promised that he was going to donate... Mm-hmm. to the Museum of the Metropolitan Museum of Art.
What happened to it?
He destroyed it.
Oh, God.
Here's some of the lies that he has said, that he has promised. This is from The Fix.
Mm-hmm.
This is from The Washington Post. He has promised a press conference to discuss his finances.
There will be little or no press conferences during the Trump administration.
Well, he promised one December 15th to talk about how he was going to
develop. He may never do a press conference, and I'm not making that up. He may never do one. And okay. He'll just and people will write things about it, but what he'll do is he'll just tweet things, and then the press treats his tweets as big news, and he can distract people from whatever he wants.
Right. Kellyanne Conway said he's going to have a press conference soon. He's just got action-packed days filled with meetings.
What meetings?
Kanye.
I don't understand.
He had to meet with Kanye.
Oh, my God.
Kanye met with Trump.
Just for that, I'm not going to listen to his music anymore, because I never did in the first place.
The only difference between Kanye and everybody else who went through Trump Tower this week, at least Kanye knows he needs a team of psychiatrists. At least that's the one.
He's aware.
He's aware.
Yeah. I sincerely, and I'm not trying to be an idiot here, but I sincerely don't know what's going on with, like, what is he doing?
Kanye?
Trump. What is he doing? Like, what are these? He hasn't been to any security briefings. Like, what is he doing?
He's just...
Does anyone know?
Nobody will know, you know. He's not going to have press people following him around, so who knows?
Nixon didn't do intelligence briefings.
Well,
and yet his foreign policy turned out so great. So.
Kanye. Do you listen to Kanye?
I love Kanye's music, and ever since I saw that the other day, I stopped listening to it.
You do love Kanye's music.
There's no arguing that he's a genius. I really do. He's extremely talented.
In what way? Is it the lyrics or just the sound?
Both. He's very smart. He's visually, he's smart. He's smart with his lyrics, his beats, everything. He's amazing. I really believe that. I also believe he's a crazy person.
I was talking before we started the show about how much I love Laura Nyro. He did a Laura Nyro sample in one of his songs. So I'll give him that.
Is it disgraceful that he said that he didn't vote, but if he did, he would have voted for Trump?
Of course it's disgraceful.
Yeah, but I mean, I feel...
Okay, so yeah. I have never...
And especially the part about not voting.
Yeah.
Because even people who voted for Trump, I respect more than people who didn't vote at all. If you voted for Trump, like I think you're nuts. I completely disagree with you. But you participated in our democracy. You had an opinion, and you went to the polls, and you tried to do something about what your point of view. But if you didn't vote at all, then, you know, that's just the worst.
Mm-hmm. What does Kanye represent in his music? What does he speak about? What's the message?
I wish I had something intelligent to say about that. I mean,
this is my show, so you don't have to worry about it.
Oh, great. Cool. I mean, he talks a lot about his life and his earlier albums. He talks about his upbringing.
It was a privileged upbringing, wasn't it?
No, I don't think so. No.
I don't know. I honestly don't know anything about his music, but I believe you when you say it's great, but I'm just not.
Yeah.
I have little knowledge of that form of music. In the last few months, my first hip hop guy that I love happened, which is Kendrick Lamar, and I'm one of those people who just—it's kind of actually kind of lame. I'm one of those white guys who just jumped on the Kendrick Lamar bandwagon.
But it's great.
But the movie, not the movie, the album, the Butterfly. What was it? To Pimp a Butterfly.
Yeah, I know what you're talking about.
Fucking brilliant album.
Obama quotes it.
Huh?
Obama quotes.
Yeah, and also I think the reason why someone like me who And it's actually made me more curious about hip hop, and because I'm sure there's a lot of brilliant stuff that I'm not aware of. But the thing about Kendrick's album is that It's hip hop, but it's, if you like any other kind of music that's R&B based, you're going to love the album because it's melodic, it's harmonic. So like a jazz guy like myself, it's so musically rich that someone like me is just going to be blown away by it. It's really amazing.
Have you listened to Frank Ocean?
No, I haven't. I am now though.
He's a gay man, yeah. Isn't he?
I don't know.
I think Frank Ocean is gay, right?
I honestly don't know. But
we have that confirmed.
The confirmation?
Yes.
But yeah, I think that a lot of Kanye's music is like social commentary. I'm not sure that the Video Music Awards, it was like a big thing that they gave him 5 minutes of airtime on the award show that was like unlike supervised or scripted. But like, okay, Kanye, you get 5 minutes to go up there and we're not going to look at anything that you want to say. And it was like this big deal that he like went out there and he nodded to the fact that his life is like sort of this artistic experiment. That he isn't, you know, everything that he does in his day-to-day life is not necessarily who he is. It's the fact that like the Americans and his fans and these people truly believe kind of the insane bullshit that he puts out there. Mm-hmm. And it's his commentary to be like, you know, you bought this.
Mm-hmm.
And so it was kind of like he took the veil off for a minute and was like, I'm not this insane person that you think I am, but you believed it.
Right.
And it was I think that he is pretty interesting, and his like, his wife and everybody that he surrounds himself by are they're artistic experiments and commentaries on our social structure and climate today.
Mm-hmm.
I think they're very interesting.
And don't forget, this is the same guy who said George W. Bush does not like black people at that Katrina benefit.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, but the whole Trump thing, though, I just can't, and not voting, I just can't get on board with any of that.
I think that even if what he's saying, if like him showing his face with Donald Trump and having a psychotic break and canceling his tour and all that was just for show, and if it was just something that he was doing to sort of be like, see, I got ya, that's almost where it's like you draw the line. Where you draw the line in sense of you are making such a statement, even if it's a show, that that's not something you can justify, in my opinion.
Yeah,
but I don't.
Just seems like an unnecessary distraction.
Right.
I mean, we're so scared right now. What?
But the distraction is not Kanye's fault. It's the fault of those who are distracted by it, though, because the day he met with Trump was the same day that the atrocities were happening in Aleppo, and the main story in a lot of news outlets was that Kanye met with Trump. And that's not Kanye's fault that was the main story. That's probably what he wanted, but it's the fault of the media that they are the ones that make that more important than the other thing.
Did you see Washington Post as recently they interviewed Denzel on the red carpet?
Oh, no, I didn't.
You didn't see? Oh, man, it's so good.
Mm-hmm.
They basically interview Denzel Washington and they're saying, and he's basically talking to this reporter and saying, you have a responsibility. He said, if you're not reading the news, you're not informed. If you're reading the news, you're misinformed.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know what his direct quote was, but he said, the media outlets in these days don't care about the truth anymore. They just want to be first.
Mm-hmm.
They want to say it first. They want to get the ratings. And he said, and he like looks this girl in the eye and he's just like, you have a responsibility, a moral responsibility to tell the truth.
Mm-hmm.
And he's like, and most of these people only care about bullshit.
Right. And it's so true.
Yeah. And it was so nice to sort of hear him call out, like, even the Washington Post, who's generally, I would say, a pretty reliable resource, for him to sit there and be like, you all should be ashamed of yourselves.
Yeah. It's very true. Very true.
I thought it was interesting.
I love him even more now, and I'm already.
Have you seen Fences yet?
I have.
It doesn't come out till Christmas.
I am going to.
Yeah, me too.
I've seen the previews for it. It looks really great.
Yeah.
So there was a big meeting at Trump Tower this past week. All the techies came.
Fuck them.
Tim Cook,
mm-hmm.
The guy from Uber, Travis Kalanick.
I have a joke about him, but it'll arrive in approximately 3 minutes.
Sheryl Sandberg, Jeff Bezos from Amazon, Elon Musk. They all sat down, And I'm not making this up. This is a true story. While this was going on, I didn't know about it. Mm-hmm. I was at the Apple store at Grand Central Station. Mm-hmm. I have a two-year-old iMac, a PowerBook, that's not working properly. Mm-hmm. And I've had to take it back 8 times.
Jesus.
They've stripped it twice, mm-hmm. and it's still not functioning.
Did you put dollars in it?
And finally, the general manager of the Apple Store at Grand Central Station is talking to me, and we're going eyeball to eyeball, and he's telling me my computer is fine. And I kept saying, you are normalizing a lousy computer. Mm-hmm. You now have, this is the 8th time I brought this computer back. You've stripped it twice. Mm-hmm. You've refurbished it twice. It really is time. I have AppleCare. It's time for a new computer. Your only solution now is to tell me that the computer's fine, even though mm-hmm. all I'm getting are beach balls. You are normalizing. This is the new mm-hmm. thing, sir, to normalize crap, to right. tell me to get used to crap. I come home that night, and I read that Tim Cook, the CEO of Apple,
right.
while I was using the word normalizing, he was normalizing Donald Trump.
Yes,
how
was.
Disgraceful is it that Tim Cook met with Donald Trump?
It's awful. But don't forget, we buy Apple products, and they're built by slave labor in China. So, mm-hmm. so we're all guilty.
So while I'm at the Genius Bar, and I talk to my shrink mm-hmm. and my loved ones mm-hmm. about this behavior.
When I go there, they only let me go to the mediocrity bar.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, that's a bummer.
I can't help myself.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just not. And I really wanted to go back that day and just say, okay, this is now going to be the 9th time I've had to take this computer in. I sure hope.
And you just refuse to clear your porn history. That's just something that's just not an option for you. That'll unclog it up. And plus you accept that jizz on the keyboards like hurts the machine, right? Did they explain that to you?
So I go in there that day, I'm not going to be a jerk. I'm just going to say, I'm sorry. This is, I know this is the 9th time I've been here this year. Mm-hmm. Could you please fix my computer? Mm-hmm. I can't do that.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm sitting there at the Genius Bar. And as I'm talking to the geniuses, I'm pointing out. And there are two women in earshot who are waiting. Very young and attractive. Tell me I'm wrong. I pay my taxes. I don't have billions of dollars that haven't been repatriated yet. And the genius goes, what are you talking about? And I say, you call yourself a genius and you don't know that Apple doesn't pay taxes to America overseas, and they're registered in Ireland, mm-hmm. and that the city of Cupertino is going bankrupt. The school system in Cupertino, where you are headquartered, mm-hmm. is going.
I was at Starbucks at that moment ordering a Cupertino.
And he goes, what are you talking about? I said, you call yourself a genius. You don't even know that Apple is registered in Reno,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
so it doesn't pay California state taxes. And I look over, these two beautiful women are waiting for their genius.
Mm-hmm.
And they just think I'm a jerk.
Mm-hmm.
And I turn to one of the beautiful women. I go, did you know that Apple doesn't pay taxes? Ignores me.
Mm-hmm.
I turn to the left. Do you know that they had to put mm-hmm. safety nets at Foxconn because the women building your iPhone were jumping to their death? And the woman was polite enough to say, no, I didn't know that.
Mm-hmm. could she have said, I do know, though, that you own Apple products, and you went out and bought them, and now you want it fixed, and you knew all that about their tax situation, and yet you supported them. So get out of the store, you cranky old man.
And get that jizz off your keyboard.
Clean your keyboard already.
I try to keep my mouth shut and get my computer fixed. How angry should I be?
I don't know. My Mac Air that I bought within the last year, I have to restart it about twice a day to get the internet on it to work.
Restart it twice a day?
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
Mm-hmm. Is that? Wow, that's, so that's even worse than...
That's awful.
Yeah.
See, I do strongly think that there is some sort of conspiracy with iPhones that once there's an updated iPhone out there, your phone, if it's not the newest version, just kind of starts to glitch and not work properly. Mm-hmm. And then eventually you've just like you've had it because you're used to your phone working seamlessly. Mm-hmm. So you go out and you buy the 7 because now the 6 doesn't have enough physical room or can't. It doesn't integrate with the new operating system. And if you don't have the new operating system, then it doesn't, then your apps that you normally use don't work.
And the 7, from what I've heard, you can't plug your headphones into it because they want you to buy their wireless.
They want you to buy the new wireless ones.
Yeah. I have coined a term. It's called planned acquiescence.
Okay.
Now, this is going to catch on, and I'm going to get a residual every time somebody says planned acquiescence. That when we were growing up, it was planned obsolescence.
Okay.
They would make phones, and then every year they'd come up with a new phone, and it would be better, so you wanted it.
Right.
Now they've pretty much, Moore's Law, they can't keep improving, so the thing just stops working.
Yeah, because really, I mean, I don't know what my iPhone is, like a 4 or 5 or something, and I just have no need for anything better than it. I'm not like... You know, I get text messages, I make phone calls, I go on the internet, like that's it. I don't even.
What they do is they say, we know that Frank Conniff just wants to use his computer for downloading porn.
Right.
And
simplest thing in the world.
And writing fan fiction for.
For my favorite porn.
Yeah, I was trying to, what's her name? Kitten Atavidas. It's some of the best fan fiction I've ever read. But we can't make any money off you, so what we're going to do is we're going to just make it impossible for you to download. This thing that you bought is no longer going to work,
and
you're going to acquiesce.
This past year, I bought a new iPad mini, which is my favorite Apple device, and it's where I do most of my writing because I write a lot on the subway and out in the world. I get a lot done that way. And I had to buy it because my Pages, which is my word processing, they kept insisting for me to get new software to upgrade. But I couldn't upgrade because my old iPad wouldn't let me upgrade. So in order to get the better upgrade for my software, which I didn't really need, but I hated those messages that came up every time I went on.
Yeah.
You know?
They won't stop.
Yeah. So I ended up getting a new iPad, which I'm quite happy with, but they really just forced me into it. It wasn't something I really needed.
Yeah.
But it's planned acquiescence. They wear you down. Yes. So I want to talk about Tim Cook and identity politics before we wrap it up. Now, Tim Cook, as we know, is a homosexual.
Yes, that's right.
The CEO of Apple.
I remember reading about that, yes.
The CEO.
Okay. I didn't know that.
You didn't know that?
No.
Okay. I'm going to ask you a question about identity politics. It's safe to assume that if you're gay at Apple, you're okay, right?
I don't know. I don't work there. I don't know if
Donald Trump had run a campaign that demonized homosexuals the way George W. Bush did in 2004.
Well, you know what? First of all, he picked Mike Pence as his vice presidential candidate. So that puts him at the top of the list of demonizing homosexuals. He picked the most anti-gay bigot in the country as his running mate, which is something, by the way, was not talked about in the vice presidential debate. But the homophobia and anti-gay agenda of the Trump administration is a very strong, very real thing.
He believes that homosexuality can be cured, right, Pence?
Yes,
he does.
He believes in gay conversion therapy. In other words, if you go to see Hamilton, you will be converted into being gay.
Do you think, but Trump did not run an anti-gay campaign.
He did. He picked Mike Pence as his running mate.
But I'm talking about this. It's all about cosmetics.
He put cosmetics on his face because he's secretly gay.
No, he ran an anti-Arab, anti-Mexican.
Anti-women. But it was anti-everything, not powerful white men, basically.
Right. But do you think Tim Cook would have shown up had Trump been, you know, running a campaign?
I don't think my guess is Tim Cook, maybe he's a Democrat and he voted for Hillary. Sheryl Sandberg, who was also there from Facebook, I'm sure she's a Democrat and she's a Hillary supporter. They showed up because Donald Trump is in power now and they're all powerful people and their power is paramount to them. It's the most important thing to them. It goes beyond ideology. And if I were in their position, I would never show my face in the same room as Trump. But that's probably why I'm not in their position.
Well, do they owe it to their stockholders to show up?
You could probably make that argument. I don't know. I think I would. My attitude towards Trump, and I don't know if every business person or whatever can, but people in politics and people in media and should all have this attitude, is that we oppose him on everything. We're not going to normalize him. We're not going to pretend that he's just a conservative who's on the opposite side of my political beliefs. I believe in this liberal approach. He believes in this conservative approach. It's not that. He's a threat to our existence, and he should be treated as such.
And he named Rex Spillerson, the head of ExxonMobil,
yes,
to be
head. Rex Spillerson was my favorite porn star, too.
Was Romney...
The spill was the funny shot.
That was it.
drill, baby. I'm going to defend Romney.
Uh-huh.
And then you get the last word.
Okay.
Poor Romney.
I honestly believe that Romney wasn't looking for a job. He didn't need to be state. But he honestly felt that Trump needed him, the country needed him. He was going to pull a Colin Powell and say, I'll be the adult in this room, and had no idea that Trump was humiliating him. But people have kind of mocked Romney, who I couldn't care less about. I detest him and his family, but Trump is far, far worse than Romney.
Oh, yeah.
But don't you think that's why Romney went to meet
him? I think the idea, when you're a person who has been powerful, who has spent so much of your time attempting to be more powerful, when the idea of being Secretary of State beckons, it's irresistible, I think. Under normal circumstances, I would agree with what you're saying, but considering that he really said that, you know, all these things about Trump being a horrible person and pointing out how immoral he is, to have said that and then go meet with him, like, I just think it was a really dumb move on his part. What I've been saying is that what I would have really admired is Trump shouldn't have been the person that Romney meets with. Trump should be meeting with Obama. And if he was true to his anti-Trump stance from just a couple months ago, when he was talking about we can't let anyone who has a mother or a sister or a wife cannot approve of this, is he should have met with Obama and said, we are going to start a bipartisan opposition to Trump. We're going to do everything we can to oppose him, and we're going to try to make it across party lines. That would have been the meeting that he should have had.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, they always said that Hitler was an evil genius. And I say he was just evil.
I think I would probably agree with that.
And I think the mistake that people make with Trump is they think he's a genius.
No.
He's just evil. There is no limit to how far you can go if you're evil.
Yeah. It's true.
And we don't recognize evil. We pretend it's not evil. We think, oh, he's so smart. He's so smart. No, he's just evil. We've had bosses.
Right.
Who aren't smart, but they get things done because they're evil.
Mm-hmm.
There are some evil people in this world.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And evil will get you very far.
Mm-hmm.
Eventually, yeah, it catches up with you and everybody else.
Yeah, that's the thing, is let's hope it doesn't catch up with all of us.
Yeah, but Trump is evil. You cannot
yes,
be.
I agree. I agree with that statement.
There is no core to him. Mm-hmm. He doesn't believe in anything other than himself and making money and the Trump name. He is evil. He doesn't know right from wrong. Occasionally, he's capable of sweetness and love. You know, I'm sure he loves his grandchildren the same way Stalin loved his dog.
Mm-hmm.
But he's evil.
Mm-hmm.
And I think Romney is not evil. I think he's stupid.
No, I agree with that. Yeah. I think it's a really good distinction to make of someone like Romney, who is out of touch probably, and who's this wealthy businessman who is not in touch and whose ideas for the government are what we disagree with, although we have something of his in place now. It's called Obamacare now. It used to be called Romneycare.
Great point. Yeah.
So, yeah, it's a world of difference. There are people like that in Republicans. Someone like Bob Dole is just some. Well, I totally disagree with the guy. I don't want him to be my president. But he's not evil. He's Trump is a whole other category.
Right.
Yeah. And what happens is people project their own goodness onto.
And I don't know if George W. Bush was evil. He might have been. But we know for a fact Dick Cheney was. And Dick Cheney was the one calling the shots.
Anyway, Merry Christmas.
On that note.
What are you doing for Christmas?
I'm actually going to go see Fences.
Oh, good plan.
Yeah, that's my Christmas plan.
Mm-hmm. And, it's opening Christmas Day,
yeah, it's
right?
opening Christmas Day. Yeah. I'm going to go see it.
That's a great plan.
And you and I are going to be at Caroline's with Judy Gold.
That's right.
And we also have a benefit coming up.
The 28th, I believe, at Union Hall.
Well, you're half right.
Mm.
No, you're completely right. December
20th. I'm completely right because I tweeted that earlier today.
Oh, good.
Union Hall, Brooklyn. It's a benefit for the ACLU, the American Civil Liberties Union.
Oh, fuck. Really? Now I don't want to do it. No, I'm kidding. I love the ACLU.
Are you a card-carrying member of the ACLU?
I am trying to get my card laminated as we speak.
Well, I can laminate it with the same stuff I use on my keyboard. That was beautiful.
That was nice.
I felt like I was at one with
you.
We
had a really nice moment there.
That was beautiful. It's a benefit for the ACLU. John Fuglesang, Frank Conniff, Jordan Carlos, Joe Firestone, and David Feldman at the ACLU benefit show, Union Hall, Brooklyn. Doors open at 7.
Great venue.
Yes, it is. Show starts at 8. It's Wednesday, December 28th. It's $10 for advance tickets, $12 at the door. Every penny goes to the ACLU, and I strongly urge people to go to the—
So if you want Nazis to march in Skokie, this is the cause for you.
I strongly urge people to visit the ACLU website and read their blogs and see the great work that they're doing. They have pretty much declared war against Donald Trump.
God bless them.
Yeah. And so have we. We're going to fight Trump every step of the way, and so should you. Give to Planned Parenthood if you have any money this holiday season. Give to the ACLU.
In Mike Pence's name.
In Mike Pence's name. St. Jude's does not turn kids away.
St. Jude's is a wonderful thing, and Danny Thomas was something. So, and I'm not even going to say anything about Danny Thomas. That's how great you St. Jude's is.
Yes.
Is.
If you loved Robin Williams, I don't think I'm speaking out of line here or being presumptuous, but if you loved Robin Williams, I think if you give money to St. Jude's, you'd be honoring his memory. Mm-hmm. And from the Showbiz Studios in downtown Manhattan, that'll do it for us.
The David Feldman Radio Program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps.